Yesterday we introduced the subject of renewal theory. We're now going to build onto that in terms of replacement decision making as one part of the support for the reliability-centered maintenance process so that we can take proper decisions regarding maintenance strategy. We're on the third day, first session, replacement decision making. We're going to talk on firstly cost and profit models, which you will find in the pages referred to in the textbook. We're then going to do an example on computerized analysis, and then we're going to look at the interpretation of the results. Right, so we start with cost and profit models. We say that after we fitted a viable distribution, successfully fitted a viable distribution to our failure data, which we will be doing when we look at the computerized analysis, we're then able to decide whether use-based preventive maintenance is an option at all, based on the shape of the force of mortality curve. You would remember that only in the case of an increasing force of mortality curve can we practice use-based preventive maintenance. But we still do not know whether such a strategy would be worth the money that expended on it, whether it will have the effect in terms of a better financial cost. Now, first of all, for it to be worthwhile, the cost of failure repair must be higher than that of preventive repair. I think that's fairly logical. If prevention costs you more than failure, why would you do prevention? Why would you try to prevent? Now, to analyze that, we denote the cost of prevention CP and the cost of failure CF. And we then, now I'm going to jump over these slides here. I want to get to the more comprehensive one, where we say the two cost quantities, we want to look at two cost quantities, the cost of failure and the cost of prevention. The cost of failure we can then define as being the cost of spare parts under failure circumstances, plus the cost of labor for failure repair, plus the production loss incurred while doing failure repair. Likewise, we can define the cost of prevention as being the cost of the spare parts under preventive circumstances, plus the cost of labor under preventive circumstances, and plus the cost of lost production under such circumstances. Now, what we do find is we find that in many cases, all three of those cost components might be higher in the failure case. In other words, what we're saying is that under failure repair, we might find that the cost of spare parts are higher than the cost of spare parts under preventive repair, because you might have consequential damage happening when you have failure. And that causes the cost to be higher. It's not so in all cases, but we find quite a few cases, or quite a high percentage of cases, where that is the case. Secondly, if we look at labor again, under prevention, you have a planned circumstances, and typically you will find that the cost of labor under planned circumstances are less than under failure circumstances. Again, it might not be the case in every for each failure situation, but mostly that is so. And the last component, which is the value of lost production, is even more pronounced, the difference. You typically find that the cost of lost production under failure circumstances are fairly high, whereas under preventive circumstances, it typically can be fairly low, because you plan the task very well, and you can even include many of those tasks in a present time where production loss is not involved, such as a present preventive maintenance shift or something like that, or maybe during other times that production normally does not go on. These quantities are defined for the situation where production does have an impact, or the loss of production does have an impact. We also find situations where that does not have an impact. That is where the failure does not have production consequences. And then, of course, the cost of production loss falls away in these two formulas. In other words, for the cost of failure and the cost of prevention, then just becomes the cost of the spare parts plus the cost of the labor involved. But mostly we will find that in the failure modes, which where we need to set maintenance strategy, the loss of production is also involved. Now, pages 412 to 416 shows optimization models for optimizing use-based preventive maintenance. These models are utilized mostly in the case of operational consequences, but also in the case of non-operational consequences, in other words, where production loss is not involved, but mostly in the case of operational consequences. Now, both operational and non-operational consequences are RCM terms. In other words, that's where the failure has either, and in RCM terms, you talk of failures with economic consequences. And you have two classes of economic consequences. The one is where you have operational consequences. The other one is where you do not have operational consequences. But then in RCM, you also have failures with safety consequences and with hidden consequences. We're not talking about them now. We're talking specifically of the class of economic consequences. And we're going to concentrate specifically on the two models on pages 412 to 416, the economic models. Those two models make use of the two quantities CP and CF to find the optimum value of the time to prevention. In other words, the time from the point that you install the component up to the point that you then take it out preventively. Whether you then replace it with a new component or whether you then recondition it doesn't matter. So it gives you the optimal time to prevention. And that would be the time that gives you the lowest cost per unit time for that component. The difference between the two models that you find on pages 412 to 414 is simply that the first one does not take the time that that you use to effect the repair into account, whereas the second one does take it into account. In actual fact, the second model is the better one to work with, because if you then don't take the times into account, you can just set those two times equal to zero and then you have the first model. So we typically work with the second model. Also in M-Analyst you will find that the cost profit model that's included there is that second model. In most cases those two models do not give significantly different answers. The only time when there's really a marked difference is when the time used to effect failure repair is a lot longer than the time used to effect preventive repair. In other words, where that really matters. The typical output from these two models is a graph of the cost per unit time against the time between preventive actions, which looks like this graph here of a Cooper split bearing. which gives the cost per day, which is exactly the example that we will be doing now. But just for illustration purposes, what this says is it says that you have the cost per day over time, and these are days between preventive replacements. So thus, if one would, for instance, replace the component at 25 days, this tells us that you will spend on average something like 220 rand per day. That would be your cost. But if you replace it only at 61 days, you would again get something like 220 rand per day. But there's a better solution, and that's around about 40 days, where you will get something like 175 rand per day. So you can save a lot of money by changing the component specifically at that age, at the age of 40 days. So that's the message of the graph. So what we need to do is we need to construct this graph from our failure data and our cost data, the two cost quantities CP and CF. So that's really what we're about to do now. Now we move into computerized analysis. We say the analysis performed to fit a viable distribution requires the power of a personal computer. So one has to do it in that way. Now for your homework sake, you are going to use a spreadsheet so that you first get into the mathematics a little bit. And then the purpose is then to move you over into MAnalyst so that you then make use of the power of that. We say here several free spreadsheets are available on our website for this purpose, and we'll show you that shortly. However, purpose-made analysis tools such as MAnalyst and RealCode provides even better answers. The main benefit of them not being that they provide better answers, but that they make the process so much easier. With spreadsheets, you can still make mistakes because you have to change certain things in the spreadsheet to accommodate a new set of data and so forth. So it is just much more reliable to work with purpose-made packages for this. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do a cost demo, and we're also going to do an MAnalyst demo. So the cost demo is based on the demo that we had yesterday afternoon regarding the viable distribution. This is a modified one where it adds cost figures, and in actual fact gives you the right answers and so forth. But it explains the concepts very well. And then we will move into MAnalyst for the remainder. We did a viable fit to example 2 based on the spreadsheet supplied on the MTech website. We showed you how you do the cost analysis on the spreadsheet. We did both of them on MAnalyst, and we also did the cost demo with a viable graph to explain exactly how the various parts fit together. We also looked into the theory of the fitting of the cost analysis process. Now we just have to wrap it up. Looking at the interpretation of results, specifically then on example 2. We say from the curve it can be seen that the optimal level of cost occurs at 40 days at 173 rand per day. It also gave us extra information apart from the fact that it gave us the optimal frequency at which it should occur. The slope of the cost graph on both sides of the optimum determines whether we will stick to that optimum rigorously. We specifically said that we would typically add 5% to that cost and draw a line through there, and then we would have two boundaries within which we want to stay. Now the 5% of course is just my figure. It might be 1% for you, or it might be 10%, whatever that figure might be. In this case with 5%, we should keep between 32 days and 48 days to remain within that 5%. Now, this specific industrial organization, there was an already existing weekly maintenance shift, which means that we had to stay within multiples of 7 days. So 32 days is smaller than 35 days, which is 5 times 7. And 42 is on the brink of 6 times 7. So one of those two we should then use. The cost at 35 days, we can then go and calculate the cost. The cost at 35 days is 176 rand per day, 42 days 174 rand per day, which means that 42 days would be the preferred frequency in this case. But we could also move backwards to 35 days if necessary. You would remember the optimum was 173 rand a day, so at 42 days you're not losing much. You're in actual fact losing less than 5%, of course, considerably less than 5%. Now the other thing that's maybe that we just have to say for record purposes is that if we go to the furthest right-hand extreme of that cost graph, the value there is the value if we just leave the thing to fail on its own. And in this case, the cost would be 391 rand per day, which is 126% above the optimum cost value. So, which shows you that it is really worth your while to practice preventive replacement in this case. The question is again is, if we look at that specific case, the question again is, should we really be doing that, or should we not be doing condition monitoring? Condition monitoring is always our first option. So the option that we were looking at here is the second option, the second best option. Condition monitoring would have been better. In this specific situation, the bearings ran in very hot circumstances and they could not get to the bearings to monitor them, according to the people involved. Of course, one will have to answer that question first before you get to the option of preventive replacements or preventive overhauls. The other thing that we should also consider is that in many such analyses, you will find that the optimum to the right-hand side of, or the sensitivity to the right-hand side of that graph is so low. In other words, the difference between the minimum cost and the just wait for failure cost is so small that you would just opt for failure. You just leave it. But you first have to go through the analysis to see whether that is so. In this case, of course, there was a tremendous difference. Just a short little comment regarding statistics. Many people has a misconception regarding statistics. You find guys that are very negative towards statistics and saying, well, you can prove anything with statistics. Then you get other guys that gets into analysis paralysis with statistics. Statistics are just a tool. It's a tool where you use mathematics to describe reality. And whether it is worth something or not depends on how well how well you've described reality. If you've described it properly, then you can get worthwhile conclusions from it. If you've not described it properly, then it's worth nothing. Unfortunately, one finds in the world, one finds many people that misuse statistics. And because of that, people get negative about statistics. Because statistics is nothing, really nothing. Statistics, as we said, is a mathematical, analytical, statistical tool. But the statistics itself are nothing. Because for everything that happens, every failure that occurs, there's a physical reason. There's something physical that happens. There's an underlying failure cause. And one could never replace your analysis of the actual failure situation with statistical analysis only. So statistical analysis one must put in its full context, in its correct context. It is a very worthwhile tool. But it is by no means, is it everything. So whenever one analyzes failure, you must look at failure from two sides, the physical side and the statistical side. And it depends on how well your data has been constituted, whether you can apply statistics in a worthwhile way. But at least when you get something in your statistics which you don't understand, go back to the physics to understand it, because it comes from there. There are causes for failure. I think that's enough. I just want to stress that statistics are a very, very important tool. So don't be negative about it, but make sure that the data that you use are valid data. Maybe one other thing, and that is that when there's always the question, well, how many failures could we analyze? Now, statisticians will tell you that some statisticians will tell you, well, you need 50 failures before you can analyze. Other statisticians which are less conservative will maybe say, well, you can do it with 15 failures. But we're engineers. And they often say that we're dangerous, and probably we are. So what we do is we analyze with less. But we must just understand that when we analyze with less, we are in a little bit of a dangerous area. Maybe not so little bit. We're in a dangerous area. But at least we have an indication of where we're heading.
From the physics.
So we have a better total approach to taking decisions than just taking it on gut feel like we normally do if we don't have the data. So my approach is, let's analyze. Let's know if we analyze prematurely, that let's know that it's dangerous what we're doing. I think, I'm not completely sure, but I think M Analyst, I've specifically made it so that you can do it on five, based on five failures you can start analyzing. But of course you're in dangerous zone, so you must remember that. Okay, I think that's enough, thank you. Please page in your books to page 405. Page 405. You will see at the top of that page, figure A5, the three shapes of the hazard function. So it shows you an increasing hazard function, a constant hazard function, and a decreasing hazard function. Now I want you to make some notes for each of those shapes of the hazard function. Please put some notes that will explain the various shapes, where they come from and so forth. Maybe at the bottom of those graphs, Or no, you can put it wherever you want to. The first graph, the increasing hazard curve, we call that a wear-out failure pattern. A wear-out failure pattern. And that corresponds to the wear-out zone in a bathtub curve. So it's a wear-out failure pattern. The second one, the constant force of mortality, is a random failure pattern. Random failure pattern. And the third one is a run-in failure pattern. A run-in failure pattern. Now I think that describes them really. In other words, the first one describes situations where you have wear out. The second one, situations where you have random failures. And the third one, a run-in situation. Now the first one, if we go back to the first one, is typical of a high wear situation. One could make that note there. It's typical of a high wear situation. The second one is typical of electronic components. Typical of electronic components, the second one. Typical of electronic components. And the third one is typical of mechanical components running under perfect conditions. What we're saying by that is that the typical mechanical component, when it's new and it has been machined as new, it's typically, it still have rough surfaces and so forth, and when you then put it into practice or into operation under perfect circumstances, you will find that slowly but surely it will bed itself in, and its risk to fail will improve with time. It's running in. The unfortunate thing is the catchword there is running under perfect conditions. We very rarely find in practice perfect conditions. Of course, perfect conditions means that no dust gets in there. It means that it is lubricated perfectly. It means that it gets no adverse shocks, and so forth, and that it is installed perfectly, not with a sledgehammer, the bearing, and so forth.
Temperature remains constant.
Yeah. So all of those constitute perfect running conditions. Now, going back to the first one again, the increasing force of mortality curve. Examples of those are ground engaging tools. In other words, like the continuous miner that we had this morning, those picks, or like a front end loader or a bulldozer or something that engages ground, those tips. Things like liners of chutes, corrosive situations, erosion, for instance, let's say in sludge pumps, even chemical attack situations, all of those. An example of the second one would be an electronic chip. An example of the third one would be a bearing fitted perfectly, perfectly lubricated, no dust, no ingression of anything foreign, and so forth.